You know she lit. Sure she wanna take pics. All she really talk about is bust down, baby, take a look at my. If I told you I spent last call.
Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. As you guys can tell by the title, this video is going to be about how I budget. So just to provide a bit of context, I started a traineeship in August and I've been there for about just over six months now, and my contract is up this August. Also, just to let you guys know, I don't micromanage my budget. The budgeting method that I've chosen to implement is not the zero-based budgeting method. I don't think there is a method for what I do. I don't do the 50, 30, 20. I take a more of a reviewing approach as opposed to a forecasting one. I like to just look back on my money. I like to plan ahead, of course, but I don't like to be stringent when I'm planning ahead. My budgeting is mostly by hand, so I have an actual budget book. So I won't be going through my budgeting book, and because that's where I actually write down like my exact numbers. So I'm not going to go through that today, but the principles still apply. You can kind of just take what you feel is valuable and apply it to yourself. So the first thing to kind of talk about when discussing income or salaries is tax, which is taken before you receive your pay, in the UK anyways. What I'm taxed is about 15% of my actual income. 15% doesn't sound like much, but it's quite a bit. So 15% is already gone before I actually get my money. Because I earn over the personal allowance, I have to contribute to the different social services that we receive in the UK. There's a bunch of things like NHS, security, benefits for certain people that are eligible for benefit, infrastructure, schools, all that type of stuff is where your income tax goes. Half of the 15% that I do pay is towards national insurance. So again, everyone pays national insurance, but not everyone pays income tax. Again, income tax is only when you're over the personal threshold, the personal income allowance, sorry. And national insurance allows you to benefit from things like maternity, like paid maternity. So when you have a baby and you go off work, you get paid. That's because you contributed to your NI and your pension as well. So, and another key point to touch on when you're talking about budgeting and salaries is whether you have any debts. So I don't have any debts, so moving swiftly on. So as for my fixed expenses make up around 4% of my income, and this is mostly because I do not pay rent. So my fixed expenses aren't as abundant as other people's. I also don't have a car because I live in London and I'm very comfortable with like the London commuting system. It's very convenient for me and relatively cheap. Also, as you guys know, it's locked down, so a lot of companies, especially companies that are really really large, have been working from home. So because of that, I haven't been paying for transport regularly either. Obviously that will change when I start going back into office. Transport will probably be a more fixed cost, like I'll probably have to buy an annual pass, or I'll just have to predict like how much I'm going to be spending on the bus or the tube or whatever. A few things under my fixed expenses would be my phone bill. My phone bill is like £30 a month, and Spotify as well. I pay for Spotify, so that's £10 a month. I would have Amazon Prime under fixed expenses, but I paid it off because I prefer to pay it off. Oh, sorry, I forgot to mention, the reason that my phone bill was only £30 is because I've already paid off my phone, so I don't pay more a month because I've already bought my phone outright. Same with Amazon Prime, I've bought that for the year for £40. The reason that I pay things off, especially if I have the funds to do that, is just because it avoids interest rates and paying so much more than what it's actually worth. Another thing that's fixed for the month is my Lockbox payments. So Lockbox is just like a credit booster savings account type of thing. But basically you make monthly payments, they save it up for you and they report the payments to credit agencies to make it seem like you've paid off a loan. I'm just doing that this year, maybe next year, because it's, you know, you can choose how much you save, but I might be doing it for this year and next year just because I don't want to start using credit cards just yet. The next part I want to touch on is my tithes. So I pay 10% of my income to my church. The reason I didn't put it under fixed expenses is because the percentage is fixed, but the money won't always be the same. I didn't set up a standing order, I just send it out every week depending on what comes into my account. And so the next part of this video will be about savings. If you're watching this video, obviously you might be wanting to get your finances in order. What I would say to you is save first. So my savings make up about 50% of my income. Put the money away, don't touch it, and pretend that you're broke. Literally, like when I transfer my money from my account to my savings account, it's gone. I don't see it. What I did used to do was I had an account that I could not take money from without going into a bank. So my bank account was not connected to that account. so I couldn't transfer like willy-nilly. They asked me, oh, do you want to link your da-da? I said no, because if you have to go into the branch, and the bank that I'm talking about, it's not even like it's a bank in my area that I can just put some shoes on and go. Like, I have to get a bus. Maybe I'm just lazy, but I don't need the money that bad, honestly. Say first and pretend that you're broke, pretend that you didn't get paid, pretend that you're living on your last shillings. It depends on if you really want to save, but if you really have something that you want to save for. I can't help you if you don't want to help yourself, type of thing. So yeah, I save into various different accounts. I have the Help to Buy ISA. Don't ask me why I have it, because it's very pointless. The first property that I'm going to buy is definitely not going to be a property that I'm going to live in. It's just the premise of like having somewhere to save. And I guess it was like one of the highest interest rate accounts. Please, the interest rate is 1%. But at the time, obviously, it was the highest interest rate savings account that you could obviously access without a fee. And the next savings account that I have is a Start to Save. This is specific to Nationwide. I was literally just opening savings accounts for the purpose of pressuring myself to save into all of these different accounts and save the maximum contributions. So I make the maximum contributions to my Help to Buy ISA, and I make the maximum contributions to my Start to Save with Nationwide. Couldn't really find accounts with minimum contributions because they would be locked. They would probably charge you a withdrawal fee. So I was quite wary about those ones. But what I decided to do was just open accounts and make the maximum contribution. So with the Help to Buy, the most you could put in a month is £200. With the Start to Save, the most you could put in a month is £100. And once that month goes, you can't put any more in. Once June goes by, you can't say, oh, I want to put £100 for June in August. It's already gone past. Like, you have to put it in the specific month. Otherwise, you missed the reward for that month. Even though the reward is small, it's the premise. You want to be on top of your savings. You want to keep that track record of consistently saving and maximizing the account, basically. And then another savings account that I save into, this one is a bit more freely because they don't really have minimum or maximum contributions. It's just a triple access savings account. Again, specific to Nationwide, I think. You only get 3 withdrawals for the year because the term is a year, and after the third withdrawal your interest rate reduces. Obviously the interest rate is relatively low anyway, so I don't give a heck if it reduces, but it's the premise. You are limited to 3 withdrawals. Even though you can make another withdrawal, put it in your mind that you shouldn't. Put it in your mind that you don't want to make more than 3 withdrawals. Whatever money is there after 3 withdrawals staying until the end of the year. It's only a year anyways. So those are all the savings accounts that I save into. Also the Lockbox counts as a savings account, but I only pay with the Lockbox, I only pay £35 a month, just because I'm a bit wary about it and I want to see if it actually helps my credit score. £35 a month is probably not enough to make a difference, but still, at the end of the year when they release the funds back to me, it'll only be just over £400, so it's not really massive, but it's still somewhere that I'm saving actively every single month and I'm committed to saving. So you need to see savings as a commitment. It should be something, it should be just as big as a debt. It should be second nature to you to save and put your money away. So a question I get asked quite a bit is, what am I saving for? Now, I don't really like this question, just because like, you don't need a goal to necessarily save. You don't need to always be saving for something in order to be motivated to save. You should just save. But for me personally, there's a short term and there's a long term. In the short term, it's kind of like a sinking fund. I know that I'm going to be taking driving lessons. I might need to buy new equipment for the job that I start in September. I might need new filming equipment as lockdown is easing. I could go on holiday next year. Just things that, like, you know, things that could come up. A sinking fund is a fund that you know is going to be drained. Like, you already know the money is going to come out of that fund, but you're saving up just in case. More longer term, I do hope to start investing in property, but that's like a ways away, but that's a while away. So another point that people do touch on in these types of videos is emergency funds. An emergency fund is basically 3 months worth of income in an account for like a bad situation, like your company goes down or you get fired, God forbid, or something like that. Something like drastic, basically, and you're out of work, or you're in an accident whereby like you're out of work for 3 months or so. You need to have income to sustain you. And the reason I don't say for an emergency fund is just because I don't imagine myself getting fired. I don't think my company is quite large, so it's unlikely that my company is going to go bankrupt tomorrow. My contract is for 12 months. My contract is not 0 hours. And I'm not looking to get fired. Like, I just wouldn't want to think, like, I just wouldn't want to think that, oh, I might get fired. No, sir. I do have the money. Like, I do have a fund that you can count as an emergency fund. Like I said, I've been saving in the Help to Buy ISA for quite a while now. Like, it's enough of an emergency fund, but I just don't want to call it that. If that applies to you, if you're working a 0 hour contract job, or you fear that you might be out of employment, or you're not really confident in the standing of your company that you work for, then an emergency fund might be very important to you or beneficial to you. So you might want to consider that when you're thinking of how you want to budget. So the next point is investments. I was watching personal finance videos, as you do, as somebody that's interested in personal finance. But the way I was looking at my money was wrong. If I'm saving 50% of my income, that's in cash. Like, saving is just keeping it in cash. And the interest rate on savings account is trash, let's just say that. They're not making any sort of return. So at the time that I was making the notes for this video, I was investing 10% of my income. But I recently did a lump sum payment into my stocks and shares ISA because I was like, there is a risk with stocks and shares, right? But I'm not a financial advisor. I'm not here to give you financial advice. The risk is very, very minimal if you're invested in either an index fund or an ETF. So when I just looked back at it, it just didn't really make sense to come to the end of my employment and have only 20% of all my money in investment. When I look at my money system at the end of my contract, I would like to see not even 60%, 70% of my money in stocks and shares. So when I say stocks and shares, I mean the Trading 212 app. And on the Trading 212 app, you can invest in funds that track bonds as well. So you can actually find very safe investments on there. So don't think that I'm saying all stocks and shares and I'm picking the shares myself. I'm not doing any of that. I have growth portfolio pies. It's like a lot of shares. So it's not me betting everything on one share or buying all of Tesla. It's like, I'm invested in a lot of different shares to hedge my risk type of thing, right? And when I look at my money at the end of 12 months, I would like to see 70% in investments, 20% in cash, and 10% is an investment as well, but it's going to be in cryptocurrency. Just to like mix it up a bit, like, why do I have all of my money in cash? It really doesn't make sense. By cash, I don't mean physical cash. I mean money just not being invested basically in my account. Another subheading to touch on under the investments category would be my nail business, because I see that as an investment. At the moment, I'm in a loss of £800. My business is separate from myself, so my business owes me £800. So the final part of my budget would be my variable expenses. So after I like the way my savings and investment accounts are looking, I pretty much spend on what I like. I don't really manage my variable expenses. I don't really manage my miscellaneous expenses, just because like it's too much micromanaging. So what I've just said does go both ways. If I don't like the way my savings account is looking or my investment account is looking, then I'm gonna have to be broke for a few weeks until I fix it up and get it back to where it needs to be at. Yeah, don't forget to like, comment and subscribe to my channel, guys. Like, literally subscribe. You know, you know she lit. Sure she wanna take pics. All she really talk about is bust down, baby, take a look at mine. If I told you I spent last quarter.